Hello, I'm Steven Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today's show about human rights education is thanks to UDC-TV and the United Nations. Professor Manfred Nowak is a professor of international law and human rights at the University of Vienna. Professor Nowak is also co-director of the Ludwig Boltzmann Institute of Human Rights. Welcome, Professor.
I'm happy to be here.
Well, we're delighted you could be here. Well, maybe if we could start with, why are human rights more important than other rights?
Because they are the most basic rights, originally defined in constitutions. So if you go back to the American Constitution and the Bills of Rights, so that is what people are most concerned, dignity, freedom, equality, these kind of basic rights. We have so many other rights. If you do your driver's license, you can drive a car, but that's not a human right. So it's really those that are existential for us as human beings, that this kind of make a difference for human beings as compared to other creatures. So it is enabling us to live a life in dignity. What Roosevelt once said, freedom from fear and violence and freedom from want and poverty. So those are the two sides.
Well, fair enough. In terms of dignity and poverty, what happens if different people or different countries have different visions of what's an acceptable level of poverty or an acceptable level of dignity that one can have?
There are always certain differences, and that's also fine. On the other hand, since World War II, in reaction to the Holocaust, in reaction to the Great Depression, etc., the United Nations were founded, and they developed a universal system of human rights. Most of the core human rights treaties are today ratified by more or less all countries in the world, all states. So we have reached a level where human rights is the only really universally accepted value system of our times. But of course, it's a flexible system. So for instance, poor countries will have a different level of what is really absolute poverty and therefore non-acceptable poverty than rich countries. But of course, the difference and the gap between the rich and the poor, that is, at a certain point we reach a level where this inequality in economics, in income, in possessions is undermining the social coherence of a society, and that is in the rich countries as much as it is in poor countries.
And then the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, if I'm not mistaken, does not really address that inequality.
It does. It does. The right to equality and non-discrimination is one of the main principles of human rights, and that goes back to the French Revolution and the American Revolution. So it's liberté, égalité, and solidarité. So in the French, it's a basic principle, and it's also covered in the Universal Declaration and in the two covenants, and there are many treaties really looking at equality and non-discrimination, so racial discrimination, discrimination against women, etc.
Well, I meant in terms of how much. Like, I think one of the things that intrigues me very much about your field, which I think is incredibly important, is how much, right? I think most people would acknowledge that the Universal Declaration is very important and perhaps one of the most important documents in the world. But to the issue of inequality, does it say anywhere that, you know, the average CEO can only make 30 times what the average worker makes?
No, it is not that specific, but of course there is a lot of jurisprudence in the meantime. So all those, the human rights are defined in a very, very vague language in order to give room for interpretation also by courts and by international monitoring bodies. But now that is fairly well defined already. And again, it doesn't say 30 times is fine and 50 times is not fine. But if you read the book of Thomas Piketty, Capital in the 21st Century, so then he says now we are reaching a level of inequality that is similar to what happened in Europe in the UK in particular, just before the outbreak of World War I. And it was one of the reasons for World War I. So societies take it. If I'm a blue-collar worker, I can say if the CEO earns 30 times as much as I can say, okay, but he's working day and night and I go home at 5 and he's more qualified. If he earns 1,000 times as me, then I'm not taking it anymore. And that's exactly the situation where we are in today. And that's a very dangerous situation for democracy, for the rule of law, for human rights, and the survival of our societies.
Well, and speaking of those societies, we're here at the United Nations, and one of the things that always intrigues me about the United Nations is how, when I travel overseas, people generally look at the United Nations in a positive way. Not always, but often. But in the United States, it seems to be almost the opposite.
But that's American exceptionalism that always has been. Of course, the US, that's why we are sitting here in New York and the headquarters is in New York. Roosevelt and the United States were very, very essential for the creation of the United Nations. And for a long time, also the United States were strongly supporting the United Nations and also its values, including human rights. I mean, Eleanor Roosevelt was the chairperson of the Human Rights Commission when the Universal Declaration was adopted, and she had a lot of impact in that. Today, the United States are the country that, among a few countries that have only ratified some treaties, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the US is the only state in the world that has not ratified it. And they don't accept individual complaints mechanisms. So it's very difficult to hold the United States accountable before any kind of international monitoring body. And of course, there's less and less support for the United Nations, which is really, I think, a very, very negative development, because we need the US. Because if the US says that, then the Russian Federation or China says the same. As you said, in many other countries, the UN is seen very positively because there's a lot of development cooperation. There is UNICEF, for instance. I'm just coming from a meeting at UNICEF. That is the UN Children Fund. They have in about 160 countries offices where they support children and the rights of children. And the same is with the United Nations Development Program and so many others. So they do a lot of very, very important work in the field that people directly feel it is improving their living conditions. World Health Organization, all that is extremely important. But for also upholding international peace and security, that is the organization we have. If we are undermining the United Nations, then we are going back to bilaterally solving disputes, and that can much easier lead to armed conflict, etc., as we have seen in the past.
Well, and speaking of that potential for conflict, what do you see as the role of universities in the United States, in Europe, elsewhere throughout the world, in trying to create this kind of human rights culture where the armed conflict would perhaps be, there's a less and less chance of that happening?
Of course, human rights violations are also one of the main reasons for armed conflicts, ethnic, religious, and other forms of tensions that lead then to armed conflicts. So, in my opinion, human rights are at the core. If human rights are well respected, and that also means that those are more democracies, countries that are based on the rule of law, the risk of armed conflict is much, much smaller. So in general, I think it is extremely important, and universities play a crucial role in that, to spread the message of human rights, democracy and the rule of law around the world, and human rights education is the best tool, and the universities are leading in that field. Of course, the United Nations and other international organizations themselves are also spreading the message by outreaching and human rights education, but definitely the universities do more in that respect.
Well, fair enough. I have a fairly provocative question. I hope you don't mind it, which
Never.
Is some people would argue that the threat of armed conflict can actually be useful in some instances. Do you agree with that?
The threat of armed conflict. That
so, in other words, you know, we the civilized world don't believe that what you're doing in North Korea, for instance,
yeah.
is a good thing.
Yeah.
And therefore, the threat of armed conflict will be a deterrent, and therefore, the world would be better off if we did have some threat of that.
I mean, that's what we call in the United Nations the responsibility to protect. That's a new concept, it was introduced by the United Nations in 2005. And for instance, it worked in a country like Cote d'Ivoire or in Libya. So that you say, but that needs to be done by the UN Security Council. If a government like the Libyan government is really using armed force against unarmed demonstrators, as it was at the beginning of the Arab Spring. So then there's a certain point where the international community has a responsibility to react and say, we have to protect those people against any form of cross and systematic human rights violations, crimes against humanity, by intervening, first, of course, by diplomatic means, secondly, by economic and other forms of sanctions. And if all that doesn't work, and the Security Council authorizes the use of armed force, then that is justified, what we before called humanitarian intervention, but only if it is authorized by the Security Council in order to protect human rights against others that might also be private actors, but very often it's governments themselves who are violating these human rights. So sometimes it is necessary in order to stop a genocide or ethnic cleansing, as we have seen in Bosnia-Herzegovina, genocide in Rwanda, where the United Nations actually at the beginning failed. In Rwanda they totally failed. In Bosnia at a certain point, with the help of the United States, with the threat, was also the threat of use of force, NATO then used force against the Bosnian Serbs, and that was the beginning for the Dayton Peace Agreement, because without that they wouldn't have come to Dayton in order to find a common peace.
But what about the threat from just the Americans without the United Nations? How do you look at that?
Of course, there's always also bilateral pressure, and that is in principle also all right. There might also be bilateral economic sanctions now, for instance, against the Russian Federation because of occupying the Crimea Peninsula and what's happening in the eastern Ukraine. That is legitimate, but unilateral use of force would violate international law because, and that's a big achievement of the United Nations. For the first time in history, Article 2.4 says that the use of force and the threat of the use of force is absolutely prohibited, with only two exceptions, if the Security Council is actually authorizing it or if it's really in self-defense.
Well, fair enough. In terms of one other thing that I noticed when we were getting ready for today was, if you were quoted correctly, I understood that you appeared on a television show in Germany asking that perhaps President George W. Bush and Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld were potentially liable for their actions while they were in office. Is that true? And if so...
Yes, of course. No, I was at that time UN Special Rapporteur on Torture. At the time of the Bush administration, I was appointed in 2004. That was just the time when the torture methods applied by U.S. forces in Abu Ghraib were all over the media, and I was involved in the first study on Guantanamo Bay, where we found out that torture was authorized and practiced by Donald Rumsfeld and practiced by others. And then George W. Bush actually said in his own memoirs that he took the decision to authorize waterboarding. Now, waterboarding is one of the classical torture methods that was used already in the Spanish Inquisition. So you cannot say waterboarding is not torture according to the United Nations Convention Against Torture. And this convention has been ratified. It's one of the few ones that was ratified by the United States. So they have an obligation to bring anybody to justice before American courts where there's enough evidence that this person directly was involved in torture or authorizing or commanding torture. And that's why I said that, like in any other country, also later to the Obama administration, there is a responsibility under international law to bring every perpetrator of torture to justice. If this is not done in the country itself, then there is even other countries have a universal jurisdiction responsibility. So that's why, for instance, when President Bush was, when he was no longer president, wanted to travel to Geneva for giving a talk. And then there was the threat that possibly the Swiss authorities could actually arrest him, and then he was not traveling anymore. So that is an obligation that applies to everybody who is torturing. And in the United Kingdom, we have quite a number of these universal jurisdiction cases where torturers from Afghanistan or from Nepal, etc., have actually been arrested and brought to justice. So the same obligation applies to the United States.
But politically, that makes things a little difficult when the United Nations is trying to gain support in the United States.
That's for every country. Of course, the United Nations, and in this case also the International Criminal Court, also have a responsibility according to its mandate, and that is to investigate crimes against humanity or war crimes or genocide against anybody, and whether this is a very powerful person or not, you should actually aim against the most powerful. And some of presidents like Charles Taylor of Liberia has finally been arrested in Nigeria and brought before the Sierra Leone tribunal for war crimes and crimes against humanity in Sierra Leone. And others like the former president of the Ivory Coast is now in The Hague standing trial. And former President Milosevic of Yugoslavia and Serbia was brought to the International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia. So that's the very idea, fighting impunity for the worst crimes that you can imagine is actually a way of preventing these crimes and perhaps also preventing armed conflicts.
That's interesting. In terms of your students, where do you want your students to go after they finish being your students? What sorts of paths do you want them to do, and what have they been doing?
Yes, we have both, for instance, in Vienna, I have a master in human rights, and in Venice we are organizing 7 different regional masters, Europe, but also in the Latin America, Africa, Asia, and other regions. They are really targeted to give them all the theoretical background, but also practical skills, in order to enable them immediately after they finish to go to the field. So the classical job that these people look for but also find is in peace operations, for instance, or working for the High Commissioner for Refugees somewhere in a crisis situation, dealing with internally displaced persons, etc., working for the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, again in difficult situations. So to send them to the field as human rights field officers, that's usually how you start, to really get field experience, and that is very, very important. And then, of course, if you make career, you finally might end up in headquarters of these organizations in Geneva or in Brussels or in New York, etc. But usually the first go to the field, and they are well equipped after they are graduating from our masters.
And what are the one or two courses that you would feature, if you could feature one or two courses that are the most important courses that people would take as they're preparing this for this career?
I mean, they have to do the whole package of the master. There is not so much choice, but what is very important, for instance, my students in the moment are still in Kosovo. So they do a field trip to Kosovo, where that's still a post-conflict situation, and that's where you learn what does it mean, because there you have all the different organizations, the United Nations, the European Union, UNHCR, you have the OSCE and others there, and they still do human rights monitoring, human rights assistance, election, etc., and there they see what it means really in a difficult post-conflict situation to start again, to build up capacity building, build up a society based on democracy, human rights, and the rule of law. And there they get the skills. I'm also teaching them, so for instance, what do you do if you are in the field and you have to interview somebody? What are you doing if you are in a dangerous situation? What are you allowed to do and what you are not allowed to do? What is stupid to do? How do you deal with very, very sensitive, which information do you give the government if you got it from the NGO? So that is really, you learn then of course much more learning by doing and learning on the job, but you need this very, very practical skills before you start working in the field.
And what about the notion of the kind of baggage, for lack of a better term, that you would bring coming from particular cultural backgrounds? So people in different countries obviously look at the world in different ways, and so then they're now going to be in Kosovo or somewhere else and interpret things in different ways.
Yes, but that's why all our students coming from all kind of different countries in the world, and it's intercultural learning. So it is of course also highly important that you develop the skills to respect other cultures. Also in terms of human rights, the worst thing is to come in particular from a Western perspective. That's what you have to do? No. You always have to put human rights, universal human rights, in the context of a particular situation and say, but there, the history, the role that the religion plays, how conservative is the society, what's the situation of women, for instance. You cannot, there is a certain, of course, non-discrimination of women, but you cannot apply Western standards to a country like Saudi Arabia. But on the other hand, if women are stoned to death for adultery, that is, in any case, a violation of the prohibition of torture and the right to equality and non-discrimination. So, but where do you draw the line? That is, again, you have to be culturally sensitive. And when in the Vienna World Conference on Human Rights in 1993, we defined this, it was saying universality, indivisibility, equality of all rights, but taking into account cultural, religious, and other difference stemming from the tradition of a particular society. That's very important, otherwise you fail.
But how do we deal with something like abortion then, where in some instances, some people think that it's a basic human right for a woman to control her own body, and other people believe that it's murder of an unborn child?
Again, there are differences even in the normative framework. For instance, if you look into the Inter-American Convention on Human Rights, they say the fetus or the human person is actually protected as from conception. So that's why we have in Latin America, because of the influence of the Catholic Church, of course, let's say, it's more difficult for human rights bodies like the Inter-American Commission and the court to clearly say a fairly restrictive attitude towards abortion really violates human rights. In Europe, for instance, that's different, but also at the United Nations level, there is developing a certain consensus that restrictive anti-abortion laws violate the right to privacy and autonomy of the woman, and there should be, you always have to balance, and what the US Supreme Court in Roe versus Wade once decided, as the Supreme Court saying it's the first 3 months that actually the woman should have the right autonomously to decide whether or not to have an abortion, that's the right approach. And that is what was started in the US Supreme Court. It was taken over in many countries. So it's this first trimester, she should be free. And afterwards, the states might restrict it further, also in the interests of health, of course, of the unborn child, but also of the mother, etc. So it's always balancing human rights. The art of human rights is always balancing different interests, and it's a very good framework for finding a compromise between state, society, and individual interests.
But in terms of the individual interest, I assume that you intellectually want to protect more and more human rights. But what
yes.
if people look at it the other way, that they think people perhaps have too many rights?
I don't think you can have too many rights. I think, but because rights also always entail obligations. If I have a right to life, then you have a right not to kill, you have a duty not to kill me, and vice versa. But if I have the right to freedom of expression, it's a very important right in any democracy. Still, I should respect your privacy. I shouldn't insult you. I should be respectful with you. That's also so. And of course, I should not misuse my freedom of expression in order to incite others to religious or ethnic hatred and violence. So I always have to deal with my. I cannot have too many rights, but I always have to also think. Exercising rights also implies certain duties and obligations to others.
But I guess my final question, because we're going to have to wrap up in a few minutes, is the issue of Syria. So if you think about the rights of people there, I mean, this has been a tragedy by any stretch of the imagination, but it doesn't seem to me that the human rights community has really been successful in preventing this.
Yes, it's not only the human rights community, it's the international community in general. It's a disaster what is happening in Syria. It's the worst crisis that we have in the moment. It was like Libya. It started in 2011 as part of the Arab Spring with peaceful demonstrations against the regime of President Assad. And at that time, if the Security Council of the United Nations would have taken a similar approach than to Gaddafi in Libya and have said, you see what happened to Mr. Gaddafi, so you have to be careful. And I'm not talking about authorization of military force. I'm talking about giving a certain message from the Security Council and perhaps also then economic sanctions. I think a lot could have been avoided. And it was the Russian Federation in particular, because of their political interests, but also military interests in Syria, that from the very beginning said the Security Council will not take any kind of decision against President Assad. And that was the beginning of the involvement of so many different states, and that's why it is in a moment extremely difficult, because you have Iran, you have Saudi Arabia, you have Turkey, you have the Russian Federation, you have everybody involved. But still, in the moment, the only thing is that we can achieve is trying at least to bring everybody together and try to not having all kind of preconditions for talks. Everybody needs to talk, so in order that you find an not necessarily immediately a peace agreement, but at least truce, so that they stop fighting against each other, and then to develop under the auspices of the United Nations a peace agreement. I think that's the only thing in the moment. This whole idea of the responsibility to protect, etc., doesn't work anymore. It's far too far escalated. And we should also deal in a humane manner with all those thousands of refugees that those millions of refugees that actually had to leave Syria. And I'm also speaking as a European, that Europe has a particular responsibility to provide those people asylum in a dignified manner.
Well, Professor, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
If you would like additional information about Professor Manfred Nowak, please visit univie.ac.at/en or bim.lbg.ac.at/en. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. And thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Steven Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.